This week, Jared Atkinson joins us to talk about hunt teaming and PowerShell and more. Security news for this week, we will talk about hacking sex toys, facial recognition, and all that and more. So stay tuned.
Broadcasting live from G-Unit Studios in Rhode Island, it's the show where exploits run wild, packets aren't the only things getting sniffed, and the cocktails flow steady. It's Paul's Security Weekly. Security Weekly is brought to you by
Black Hills Information Security, the leaders in penetration testing and active defense. Email consulting at blackhillsinfosec.com to request a quote today. The SANS Institute, the most trusted source for computer security training, certification, and research. Visit sans.org to explore the full curriculum and latest training offerings. Onapsys, the leading provider of solutions to protect ERP systems from cyber attacks. Customers can secure their SAP and Oracle business critical platforms from espionage, sabotage, and financial fraud risks. Visit them on the web at onapsys.com. Pony Express. Check out their line of penetration testing devices, including the Pwn Pad, the Pwn Phone, and the Pwn Pro. For enterprises, there's Pwn Pulse, providing continuous visibility into wired, Wi-Fi, and Bluetooth spectrums across all physical locations, including remote sites and branch offices. For all those hard-to-reach places, there's Pony Express. Visit them on the web at ponyexpress.com. Welcome, everyone, to Security Weekly. Did you have something to introduce me there?
No, no. I was actually going to say to you in the beginning, so you know, we forget it so much, and I haven't been in studio as often. It's probably time for me to just let that go by the wayside.
Okay, here's your host, a man who apparently only has one green shirt, Paul Acidorian. How about that? Is that good? Welcome, everyone. This is Security Weekly.
That works.
Episode, what number is this?
456.
456.
That it is.
That is right. And it is even March 17th, 2016.
St. Patrick's Day.
St. Patrick's Day. And we're in celebration of St. Patrick's Day. Not only are we wearing green, but we're drinking. You know, how can we not honor the great holiday of St. Patrick's Day by drinking?
It was a stretch, but
we thought, it's so far outside of the norm for Security Weekly.
I know.
But we thought this week, you know what, we're going to drink extra.
And you know what the special drink is for St. Patrick's Day in the Paul.com
Security Weekly?
I've been drinking in the Security Weekly studio.
Edit that one out.
It's called booze.
Beep.
Where's that thing on your wrist? You need 100%.
Yeah, and then you need the shocking thing. Yeah,
shock
100% shock every time. Larry's got the shocker, literally the shocker. Well, Larry's here in studio. Larry, yes. It's nice to have you in studio as always.
Yes.
Mr. Jeff Man. I almost said Joff Man. No, it's Jeff Man, Joff Thayer. Not Jeff Thayer and Joff Man.
Jeff
Man is here. The man. You're the man.
I am the man.
You are the man.
Mr. The Man.
You've been playing mixologist so far.
I've been having fun.
That's good.
Trying to come up with green drinks that aren't beer.
And don't taste like mouthwash.
Yeah, that first one was mouthwash, dude.
The first one wasn't so good.
I think cream to mint is out. Mouthwash.
Yeah,
I think that's the main ingredient in that is Listerine.
Oh. Well, Keith was saying that was one of those liquors that was in your dad's liquor cabinet and it was there for like 20 years.
For like 20 years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because nobody knew what to do with it.
Put it over ice cream, I'm told.
Ice cream.
Nice.
We used to put it over pineapple.
Yeah.
Oh,
that was pretty good. Right.
It's pretty good.
So
we'll get some pineapple.
It's going to sit on the shelf over there for quite some time.
We'll put a date on it. Take there a picture of it. On the lines via Skype, Mr. Carlos Perez is here. Welcome, Carlos.
Hey, Paul. Happy to be here.
Wow.
Surprise!
Live video from Carlos.
I know.
It's awesome.
It's the first time for everything.
Adorning his Hack Naked t-shirt, Mr. Joff Thayer is here with us. Welcome, Joff.
Hola. It's good to be here. It is March 17th, no less, St. Patty's Day. It is also my daughter's birthday, who is 17 on the 17th, which is... freaking me out.
Why are you here?
And I don't have any green on, so I'm in trouble with my wife and my daughter, and I'm doing Security Weekly tonight. So awesome, awesome coincidence of events.
Is that a recliner in your office?
A recliner? What, you mean that I'm sitting in?
No, behind you.
Behind you.
No, it is not a recliner in my office.
Okay. Is that just clothing over a treadmill?
No. Some musical equipment because I'm vaguely musical from time to time. So.
I see.
Gotcha.
I hear you're an expert in the skin flute, Joff.
Oh, you had to go there. Actually, I can play some mean blues on the keyboard.
You can play some mean skin flute.
Blues on the skin flute.
It's good. Now I lost my train of thought.
Do they celebrate St. Patrick's Day?
I amaze even myself. I amuse myself.
And
if you can't amuse yourself, who can you amuse?
And little else.
And little else.
Yeah, well, you know how it is. You got to practice on yourself before things are perfected.
I want to talk about InfoSec World, April 4th through the 6th. And I had a lot more stuff to say about InfoSec World in the show notes that don't really exist. But there's a beautiful graphic there up for InfoSec World.
At Disney's Contemporary Resort, no less.
That's right. InfoSecWorld.misty.org. I really thought I was going to...
Go check the show notes for $4.55.
Misty.com. InfoSecWorld.misty.com. That's MISTI.com. You should go there because I'll be speaking. Jeff got a sneak preview of my talk today, which it's still got some molding and shaping to do. It's getting there, but it's got the makings of a great talk. So Mr. Michael Santarcangelo will be there speaking as well. Who else? A lot of people we know. Kevin Johnson will be there. I think Chris Nickerson will be there. There's a lot of people you recognize, and a lot of people you may not recognize. It's a great conference. It's kind of like that mix of people who talk at HackerCons and people that are more like, business focused, I guess. I hate to call it business focused because I think we're all business focused in some way, shape, or form. But it's a great conference.
We'll call that layer 8 focused.
Layer 8 focused.
Yeah. In fact, that was my first security conference.
Was InfoSec World?
Yeah, in Florida.
Nice.
I remember that was back in 99 or 2000, and it was inside of Disney World that year.
Yes, that's where it is this year as well. So it's a good excuse to go to Disney. Go seek warmer weather.
Well, for Carlos, seeking warmer weather means not much
at all.
Staying
at home.
That's true.
Yeah. Just open the window.
Our guest this evening is Jared Atkinson. He is the Hunt Capability Lead with Veris Group's Adaptive. Before working with Veris Group, Jared spent 4 years leading incident response missions for the U.S. Air Force Hunt Team, detecting and removing advanced persistent threats on Air Force and DOT networks. He is passionate about PowerShell in the open source community. Jared is the lead developer of the PowerShell Forensics Project, an open source forensics framework for PowerShell, and maintains a digital forensics focused blog. Jared, welcome to the show.
Hey guys, what's going on? Really honored to be on the Hacking Sex Toys episode.
Yes, you're more than welcome to stick around for the Hacking Sex Toys segment.
Can't wait.
It'll be fun. Maybe Larry even brought some examples.
I wish I had if I had thought about it. But
he bought toys?
Different kind of toys, Joe.
That vibrate.
So, Jared, how did you get your start in information security?
Yeah, so it was actually kind of like a series of fortunate events for myself. Was a history major originally in college, the Air Force, and I was in Air Force ROTC. The Air Force actually uses like alphanumeric codes to represent your degree. So history happened to be 0GYY. And then later I found out that they actually mistyped and put me as 0CYY, which ended up being computer science. And so for the first, 3 years of my Air Force career, the Air Force thought I was a computer scientist. And so
that's awesome.
Yeah,
you went with the inevitable then.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, well, I mean, either that or I would have still been in college, I guess, after pursuing history, right? That's what you keep doing is get higher degrees.
Joff, we know someone that has a very similar story that he went to become a microwave repair technician.
We do?
Yes.
And ended up in the Air Force?
Ended up in the Marine. Well, no, he was in the Marines and went to re-enlist.
That's somebody. Yeah.
He picked a microwave repair technician, thinking he was going to be sitting in the kitchen with Cookie repairing microwave ovens.
Nope. Instead, you're in the battlefield repairing microwave communications nice. Devices, yep. right?
Yeah, the video, the Matrix runs on Windows XP comes to mind by College Humor, right? Hello, Neo. Would you like some cookies? Anyway.
So, Jared, I'm also told that you're part of the PowerShell Mafia. Is that like...
Oh, boy.
Is that like a gang? Do you have like a gang symbol? Do you all sit around in like a dark back room and eat meatballs and smoke cigars and drink wine and stuff?
We're going to lose that. Yeah,
so probably can you closer tell us? To the eating meatballs and smoking cigars. So Veris Group, the Adaptive Threat Division, has quite a few PowerShell fanboys, I suppose. So Matt Graver, Manifestation, works with us. Harmjoy, Will Schroeder. So there's just a bunch of us that are really interested in the open source PowerShell like InfoSec community, something that we participate with Carlos pretty frequently with. So we have like a chat room on Slack that we all kind of trade ideas and thoughts on different projects that we're working on, things of that nature.
Cool. So what are some?
You notice he didn't answer your question.
He didn't. He was very cagey about the PowerShell Mafia. Oh, man. And we probably shouldn't even mention PowerShell Mafia on the air. Now they're going to be after us. That's it. We're done.
Yeah. You're on the list.
Well, and you know, we are in political season, so cagey is the word of the day.
That's right. So, tell us about some of the PowerShell projects that you've been working on.
Yeah, so Power Forensics is probably my favorite. It's the thing that I've spent the most time on. Ultimately, what it is I saw a problem in the forensics community. There's tons of vendor tools out there. They're all closed source. None of them are particularly built to work together. And so I decided that, you know, PowerShell in general has the ability to access Windows APIs, things of that nature. And so I decided that I would start writing something that in a forensically sound manner was able to parse the NTFS file system. And so started off by parsing the master file table, the master boot record, things of that nature. And ultimately, it has kind of gone on to being able to parse the registry and a bunch of different registry keys and prefetch, things of that nature. And so really, the cool thing about it is that the NTFS parsing capability gets built upon for every particular forensic artifact. So when you want to parse the prefetch, you're going to start with a handle to the C drive, and then you're going to parse, you know, the volume boot record, get to the master file table, find where our particular prefetch file is on disk, the bytes that represent that, and then you're going to try to interpret, you know, those bytes into a prefetch file and, you know, the information that's stored there. Another pretty cool tool that I'm working on with Matt Graber is called Uproot IDS. And so that leverages WMI's permanent event subscriptions as an IDS type feature. And so WMI in general, it's, you know, been around Windows Management Instrumentation, been around since Windows 95 all the way to Windows 10. So pretty much any Windows system that you're going to come across is going to be there. It has a feature that allows you to basically monitor for events to occur. And that feature is already there. It's already running on every operating system. What we're able to do is take particular events or queries and tell WMI to notify us every time an event matches that query. And so we look for things like, it could be as broad as every time a process starts, I want to be notified about it. And it could be as specific as, when somebody uses the Win32 process create method to create a remote process on a system, we want to know about that. We want to know what the arguments to that process are, what actual executable is being run, things of that nature. So that's pretty cool for scaling out your detection capability.
That's pretty cool. Go ahead, Joff.
Yeah, can I ask a question on that? Sure. So, actually, it's interesting you mentioned that, because I was looking at WMI just this week. Okay. My question is, are you concerned about the longevity of WMI, given that PowerShell's sort of pivoting towards WinRM? And, you know, is Microsoft made any kind of commitment towards longevity of WMI, or are they going to move away?
Yeah, so WMI is the Windows implementation of a common standard called SIM, the Common Information Model. And so ultimately, in Uproot in particular, we're actually using the PowerShell SIM commandlets, which is SIM leverages both, it can leverage either DCOM or WinRM as a transport mechanism. And so you're still at the end of the day accessing the same WMI classes on the actual system, or SIM classes, depending on what you're looking for. But you can use either WinRM as a transport or DCOM as a transport. And so DCOM is going to give you the full breadth, right? So everything from Windows 95 to Windows 10 and all the server versions in between. WinRM in particular is going to give you Windows 8 by default, and then, you know, all the way up to Windows 10. You could also get it on Windows 7 and Windows XP. So
very good. I didn't actually pick up on that. So thanks for clarifying.
Yeah, no problem.
The other question was malware in general. There is definitely evidence of malware using WMI storage.
Yeah.
For payloads. And pivoting kind of purposes as well. If you look at the Empire project, which I'm sure you're familiar with,
I am.
So any
works.
Yeah,
any of the work that you're doing on the defensive side there, are you looking at it from the perspective of payloads and things stored in different WMI classes?
Yeah. So the WMI event subscriptions are all built off of classes that already exist, and so there's an __ event filter class, which basically will maintain a query. So you could say, select star from Win32 process. And then you usually would give it like a time interval that you're going to check, right? And so you could say, select star from Win32 process within 10 seconds or something along those lines. Then you would have a consumer. And so by default, there are 5 different types of consumers. Active script event consumer, which allows you to run an arbitrary VB script, which is VB is a big pain in my side. There's a NT event log event consumer, which allows you to write out to the event log. There's like an SMTP event consumer, which you can send an email, not necessarily scalable, but kind of interesting. And so you end up marrying those two things together and saying, hey, I want filter X to be married to consumer Y via what they call a binding. And then when an event occurs that matches that filter, it's going to execute whatever your consumer is. And so in the case of Uproot, one of the kind of default consumers that we use is this VB script, which I actually stole from some research that Matt Graber was doing with APT29 while he was at FireEye. They were actually using event consumers to be able to call out to the internet and download their tools or whatever. Mm. And so for persistence. And so I ended up basically using that same COM object. It's the Internet Explorer COM object. Every time an event occurs, it's going to kick off an HTTP post request, and you can send that out with all the data revolving around the event that occurred to Splunk or Logstash or any of those types of tools. So it's pretty
very, very cool. Very cool.
Yeah, so it's pretty interesting because we've really actually almost learned from the malware authors on how to leverage this technology to do defense as well. So that's been interesting research.
There's a nice symmetry to that.
Right, exactly.
Carlos,
you're muted, buddy.
What will you say to all of those proponents out there that say that PowerShell's not forensically sound?
Oh my gosh. Yeah, so
this is a softball, right?
Yeah.
That was a plaintive question.
Yeah, so Carlos.
It's a thorn in his side that I know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So one of my coworkers, Justin Warner, he's one of the main contributors to Empire. He told a bunch of buddies of ours that they like to troll me every time I tweet about Power Forensics or something, just to say, oh, yeah, I thought PowerShell's not forensically sound, and kind of make fun of it. And so Carlos knows that just, you know, irks me quite a bit. So PowerShell in general, I mean, is as forensically sound as you're going to make it, right? And so the idea behind Power Forensics in particular is that the only Windows API that we're actually using is the Create File API, which gives us a handle to the hard drive. And so when you're doing, for instance, using DD to make an image of a disk, you're going to use, you have to get a file to the disk in order to read from the disk, right? And so that's what we're doing. Once we get that, we start reading in bytes, and then we all the interpretation of bytes and determining, you know, where the partitions are, you know, where the master file table is, where a file's contents actually exist on disk. That's all completely done through code that we've written. So, you know, if somebody hooks a Windows API that allows you to read a file, for example, that's not going to affect Power Forensics, you know, forensic capabilities. It's also because we're reading it this way, we're never actually touching a file per se. We're just touching bytes which happen to represent a file. And so in doing that, we're not altering timestamps and things of that nature that might be considered forensically unsound.
Now, I know that in the information that we got from you is that you have been working in incident response, specifically in hunting. That term has been thrown around in many conferences, but very few people actually explain what incident response hunting is actually about. What are the advantages it provides? Can you explain a bit more about that?
I was going to ask the same question, Carlos.
Cool. Yeah, so hunting, from my perspective, has almost started to take on the same kind of connotation that threat intel has taken on, right? So it started off with these really cool ideas, and then, you know, the marketers got a hold of it and ended up kind of making it mean not so much or not as specific of a thing. But originally, the hunting, I would argue, was kind of started within the DoD, right? And so in the Air Force, we used to say, you know, the idea of hunting is built off of the assumed breach mentality, right? So at the end of the day, if you're a large enough organization, there is likely somebody that's going to be well-funded enough to be able to gain access to your network. And I mean, we see that in pen tests and red teams all the time. All you have to do is send, you know, 20 people an email, and somebody of one person of those 20 people is going to click on it, give you access, and then it's just a matter of, you know, finding where a domain administrator is logged in, getting access to that system, via like a, you know, reuse passwords on local administrator, and then escalating, right? And so, you know, we have this defense in depth concept that we've been using over time. And defense in depth is great, right? You need to have some baseline to where you have AV and intrusion detection and things of this nature. But you need to, the idea behind hunting is that those things aren't enough, right? You know, there's some person or some organization that has, you know, infiltrated your network, bypassing all those capabilities. Those things are for kind of the low-hanging fruit. And so the idea is that you're ultimately going to take humans, right, a well-trained human that's going to actively go out and look, you know, scan the network, look for processes, services, all types of artifacts, I guess, and look for evidence of an intrusion. So it's more, I guess, much more pro. It's similar activities to incident response, but you're doing it without a starting point. You don't have that, you know, patient zero that you would have in incident response. And you're also doing it at a much larger scale, right? Because incident response, you have a starting point. You have somewhere that you're going to, you kind of find those pivots, right? You find, okay, so this computer that I know has had an intruder on it, right? It has network connections to this other computer over here, so I'm going to go investigate that system. Well, what we're doing is we're just scanning every system, trying to figure out where something, you know, an anomaly is, and then investigating that anomaly to determine whether it's benign or actually something malicious.
But Jared, we've been doing this for a long time. I mean, if you look at the general definition and the general description that you gave, this is something we've been doing for a long time. For example, when I worked at the university in 2001, I knew that if there was a particular banner on a system or I saw a specific pattern of traffic leaving, that system was already compromised. And because I was one security person with, you know, well, back then it wasn't a gigabit, right? But, you know, 20,000 students, 20,000 or 30,000 networking devices, and all these people, I couldn't do the preventative or detection. I just went right to like looking for what was already compromised. So we've been doing this for a long time. So what has changed over time that this has become like a thing?
Yeah, so that's a good point. So
that's
I think
the marketing kicks in.
Yeah, I think there is a serious marketing piece to it, right? But I think ultimately a lot of very large organizations. So maybe it's kind of a, you know, taking your organization and having them specifically, you know, go out and engage, right? So as opposed to just the one guy that's trying to figure out, you know, do his best, right? A lot of people have written batch scripts to be able to, you know, do system startup scripts and run and, you know, list out all processes and things of that nature. But this is almost a concerted effort that an organization is taking towards being more proactive about their defense.
So, Jared, do you do this on... Is this an activity that you do on the endpoint? Is this something you look at the network traffic? Do you look at net flow, or do you look at the logs, or are you looking at everything?
Yeah, so you're looking at everything, but I think, so in general, right, you're looking at everything. I think from my perspective, hunting is really being much more aggressive in the way that you look at the endpoint.
So is hunting a philosophy, or is it a technology?
It's a philosophy, I believe. Okay.
That's the way you seem to be describing this, more of a philosophy.
Yeah.
The way I see it is that typically in your environment, you have your IDS, your IPS, you have your SIM. It has a couple of rules for looking for stuff. And in your typical environment, something triggers, and then you go to that host and you go, hey, I think I'm compromised. Let me go into this host. Start looking at what happened there, and then I start moving laterally across my network to see if I can detect any of those indications that somebody was in my network. Sure. Now, when it goes to hunting, is that you have a specific set of rules, specific set of actions that your team has already planned and is constantly looking for and going into the different systems and just going in and looking at the data without having that initial trigger that tells you, hey, right, I'm compromised. You're looking for that. You're looking at it. And also when it comes to hunting, one of the things that I've seen between red and blue teams is that here comes red. They go like, this is how I got in. Here come, and they work with blue and they tell them, this is how you would have detected me. And they are constantly feeding inside of those loop where I typically see hunting when red works with blue. That's where you see a very good hunting team that actually feeds out of each other and have that cycle of information sharing.
Well, for me, and I've been kind of not forthcoming with all the information about me on this topic, right? I'm the CEO of Offensive Countermeasures, as I recently announced, and we do have a product that falls in this space. So I'm asking questions as if I don't understand the space for the benefit of our listeners who may not be as familiar with the space as some of us here on the show today. But so having that, I'll ask another question, which like I have my answer to, but I want to hear Jared's answer too. Sure. So it sounds like over time we have been, we should be, if we're going to embrace hunt teaming, we should be less focused on the preventative side, less focused on the detection side in that you're trying to detect the attack, and we're looking at the hunting for the result of a successful attack.
Sure. Yeah.
Also
so
the behavior.
And yeah, behavior too. No, that's your behavior that results from a successful attack.
I think I've got some great follow-ons potentially to that.
Go ahead. I'll let you.
Yeah.
Go
I think ultimately it's a maturity deal, right? So the preventative stuff in a perfect world is going to be just kind of, you know, standard, right? That's like antivirus is going to be there. Intrusion detection is going to be there. You have people that are trained to
antivirus. Yeah. I would say antivirus, firewalls, intrusion detection prevention, sure, right, fall in that preventative category that you need that to just get rid of the, as I was saying before, the low-hanging fruit.
And yeah, right? We were talking about this earlier.
Yeah, I overuse the term low-hanging fruit and trying
you
to...
You do.
Trying to... but that, it was appropriate there, right?
It was.
Okay, good.
More or less.
Well, he's really talking about...
Sorry, so, go ahead, Jared. No, go
so
ahead, Jared.
Now would be a good time just to ask the basic question, what do you, you know, define the term? What do you mean by hunting? Because Paul has an idea, Jared has an idea, but just, you know, in general, what's the definition of the term?
Yeah, so I think the general definition of the term is specifically going into your network with the idea that there is likely an adversary and then looking for indicators of that adversary's activity. And I'm not talking, when I talk about indicators, I'm not necessarily talking about, you know, signatures for PlugX or something like that. I'm talking about specifically, you know, that's where Carlos kind of comes in with what he was saying about the red and blue, right? So during the attacker methodology, right, you have certain things that you need to do, right? And so let's say privilege escalation is one of the things that an attacker must do in order to achieve their objective, whatever that objective may be. So maybe we want to go out and specifically look for privilege escalation techniques, right? So things like at jobs or scheduled tasks or services that have had different binary paths associated with them, things of that nature. And so we're just going to go through the entire network and look for any evidence of privilege escalation having occurred.
So are you looking for evidence that it's happened or evidence that it's the capability is still there?
Yeah, so you would in hunting, I think you're specifically looking for evidence that it's happened. Okay. But I think there is definitely value in looking to see if it's possible, right? And so that's where I think that's kind of more of a pen test or vulnerability assessment type field, to where you're, you know, doing that you take somebody's standard image or gold disk and you assess it to determine whether or not, you know, services are vulnerable to some sort of privilege escalation attack and things of that nature.
Gotcha. So I'm desperate to make a comment here, but
go Joff.
Quick, let's talk over Joff so he can't.
Go Joff.
Yeah.
All right. So Larry was so next, but then Jeff Joff went, and now Jeff and the Joffs are trumping you.
Go Joff. It's fine.
So I teach a little bit about this topic, and I'm pretty actively involved. So full disclaimer, and I work with Paul on this particular topic. So. But I think the there's an interesting observation that Paul made, and that is those of us who grew up in the space of university, which I did as well, hunting is very intuitive because that's all you've got. And Paul like went straight to that intuitive space, and I totally get that. But for those who live in the world of much tighter policies, much tighter defense, which is most of our corporations, the concept of hunting is a little less intuitive. And I think that's where the leap needs to be made, that, and you said it very well, Jared, and that is with hunting, you're assuming that compromise has likely occurred and you're searching for those macro level indicators of compromise, right? You're searching for those bad citizen behaviors in the environment. So that's the leap that I think a lot of our customers kind of have trouble making. A lot of our people that we deal with have trouble making that leap because they're used to a world where their defensive solutions are working well and they don't feel like they have to dedicate those resources towards that hunting.
Or aren't they just comfortably numb? You know, they.
Well, that may be true also, but I think that's where, you know, I think Paul and I almost like together on this issue are like, but wait, this is so intuitive. This is so natural.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you grew up in a university world, that's exactly what you did. Like you were hunting all the time because there were no defenses.
Well, and to build on Joff's point, when you're working at a university, for example, you don't have oftentimes the budget to implement all of those fancy security things that we talked about earlier, firewalls, IDS, as much as you'd like. You also don't have control over a large portion of your user base, which means that people are getting owned and there's nothing you can do about it. So you might as well just go look for who's owned because that's the only thing you can do about it. When you're in a corporation, I think that I'm trying not to say that like you're cocky about your security posture. You're more confident. You have more confidence in the security of your network because you have more control. But you have more control. Yeah.
Allegedly ultimate control.
Right.
I do want to bring up one more point that I think Jared was probably about to make anyway, but I'll make it. And that is, it's a difference between known bad and unknown bad. I mean, your traditional defensive technologies work very well with known bad, right? Known research threats. The unknown bad is where hunting activities come into play.
So Larry, sorry, yes. I want to give Larry the floor now. Sorry, you've been waiting so patiently.
No, it's not a problem. So I want to tie a little bit of potentially the hunt to some PowerShell.
Sure.
Yeah, good. Please ask a question of our guests because we've been talking. We haven't given poor Jared the opportunity to talk in this whole thing. Sorry, Jared.
So Jared, you know, thinking about getting some information potentially for doing some hunt out of PowerShell, is there any way we can get logging from PowerShell and have them being segmented and sortable in some fashion enough so that we can organize them and make them useful?
Are you specifically asking about logging of PowerShell?
Yes, logging of PowerShell, yes.
Yeah, so that's going to be when you upgrade to WMF5 or PowerShell version 5. It has tons of additional logging mechanisms. So it does script lock logging, for example. Literally everything you run is going to be logged out to the Windows event log. Then you're going to need to use something like Windows event forwarding to forward that into a centralized SIM or Splunk or something along those lines. But it really starts once you've upgraded to PowerShell 5.
Now, okay. You say upgraded. Does that mean it's tied, that PowerShell version 5 is tied to a specific operating system version?
So Carlos probably has the exact answer, but I believe PowerShell version 5 comes standard with Windows 10.
Yep. Yep.
And then
you can actually upgrade 2012, yeah, Windows 7, 2008 R2.
Gotcha.
Are you sure 7's included, Carlos? I was looking for that exact answer this week.
Now, when you're working with 7, there's a caveat there. You need to first install .NET Framework 4.5, upgrade to Windows Management Framework 4, and then from 4, upgrade to 5. There's an upgrade path that you need to go through.
Followed by a root canal and drilling out your
Now, but when we look at PowerShell, one of the things, it's being abused by many in the red team, but also as a great person that I know, Lee Holmes, always mentions is when you compare PowerShell logging to what you get from Ruby, Python, VBScript, and CMD batch files, PowerShell actually rocks for the blue team in terms of what they provide, even in version 3, 4, before that stuff in 5. Compared to all of the other scripting solutions out there that log nothing at all in a system, PowerShell at least tells you, hey, I ran at this time, I ended at this other method, this were the modules I loaded. It all depends on how you configure everything, but it gives you a trail for you to follow versus some of the other tools out there. And that's where one of the key things that Jared mentioned before, maturity level of the organization comes into play. If your organization is mature enough to know all of this stuff and have researched it and implemented it, they have a heads up on everything that's happening. If they don't, well, shame on them.
Can I go back and touch on the hunting concept? I had
sure.
Okay, yeah. So
absolutely.
So I think Paul touched on this, but. The idea behind hunting, it almost is like a grassroots effort or kind of like the guerrilla warfare concept of computer security. So ultimately, you have these large organizations who have like nearly unlimited budgets as far as cybersecurity or computer security goes. And so they're looking to find some automated solution that they can pay for, right? Pay for it once and then or maybe multiple times over a year with a fixed cost. And then they just are good, right? And so they want this shiny box that's going to do, you know, magic and stop bad guys from attacking them. When ultimately what the hunting concept kind of goes towards is investing in people that are going to be able to kind of use their intelligence to do things that a box isn't capable of doing at this point, right? And so I think a lot of the organizations that really can use hunting are these larger organizations that specifically have the budget to just buy whatever they, you know, whatever the next fancy security solution is.
That would be Paul's company.
We make it fancy with some nice packaging. It comes with a bow and the whole.
Yeah. Nice.
So to be
glitter,
a,
it's great.
To be a total shill about this, because I'm working with Paul.
Wow.
Don't you think that some data analytics technology can be assistive, though, in
I do.
That respect?
I do. I completely subscribe to that theory.
No, So I wasn't saying that in the sense that you shouldn't buy security solutions, right? Security, at the end of the day, data analytics, like something as simple as Splunk or a database or, you know, even fancier things are important. But organizations need to understand that investing in their human resources is going to be very beneficial.
Mm-hmm. Mental yeah, if you sell make a product our products training. More fancy.
So got what it, I'm hearing it. Is...
Well, I think he's bringing a forward a really good point, and that is... There is no, you know, smoking gun, silver bullet, especially in the hunting space. Right. There's more of a...
in any space.
Yeah, in any space, truly. But there's more of a anomalous detection, kind of highlighting technology that might highlight the challenges, but it still takes a very smart human to actually chase them down.
Mm-hmm. But that's not what I want. I want something just to tell me what's been owned in my environment. Tell me what's compromised. 100%.
Like true, so to that.
Speaking like a true
no
CEO.
False negatives, no false positives. 100% so tell me what's compromised.
The kiosk in the lobby is
then you
compromise.
Have to look at behavior.
Who cares? What difference does that make?
You need to invest
I still
in
know
AI
about it.
And behavior analysis.
Yeah. So to behavior analysis and more PowerShell. Without PowerShell logging, is there any way that we can do PowerShell remoting observation, PowerShell injection? And what type of footprints are we looking at from either red team or attacker activities?
Yeah, so Matt Graber actually came up with a really cool signature for Uproot, for example. So PowerShell in and of itself, the PowerShell.exe is just a console or an interpreter, right? So underlying there is the system.management.automation DLL, which contains all of the classes, .NET classes that make up PowerShell.
Right, and so very much Ben 10 PowerShell without PowerShell.
Exactly, yep. And so ultimately what's happening is things like Empire are injecting that system.management.automation DLL into other processes, right? And so in order to actually get PowerShell execution in LSAS, for example, like they show in their presentation, you have to have that PowerShell DLL, system.management.automation DLL, loaded into that process's memory space. And so what you can do with WMI event subscriptions is say, hey, I want you to monitor Win32 module load trace, that class, for when system.management.automation.dll is loaded into a process that is not PowerShell.exe or PowerShell_ISE.exe. And so that's literally as simple as it gets, because there's no reason for
it. It's hot.
There's no reason for it to happen in something that's not PowerShell.
This makes me moist.
There you go.
Is it? On the cigar pocket, we call that wet spot in my shorts.
There we go. Now we can transition onto sex toys, right?
Nice. So, nice, that's awesome. So what I'm hearing is this is philosophical, this is technique, this is intuitive for those that grew up in a university environment. There's tools involved that help the process, but what are like the top three or five sort of techniques or things that you do if you're in an organization and you want to attempt this thing called hunting? How do you recommend somebody getting started?
It's really simple. You go into your email.
That was
program.
A question for Jared.
Yeah, you go into your email Paul, program. You send an email to sales@offensivecountermeasures. Oh no, sorry, I'll stop now.
Besides, buy your product.
Oh man,
just kidding. Sorry.
Yeah, so I think one of the best things that you could do is really get your people familiar with operating system internals, whether that depending on what type of operating system you have in your environment. So knowing things as simple as SVC host, needs to be running out of Windows System 32, and it needs to have certain command line arguments associated with it, is very valuable when you're going through a list of tons of processes, right? I think if you look at the FireEye or the Verizon comes out with their annual report, the number one malware name is svchost.exe, because there's 47 of them running on your computer at any time, right?
Right,
and so
right.
Just kind of blending in, and so being familiar with what is normal and what's not normal, I think, is probably one of the best skills that you see from people that are doing well in this space.
But that's true of security in general. Is
agree
knowing what's normal so that you can detect what's not normal. I mean that's
again,
eons
we come
old.
Down to the material level of the organization. What is the material level of that organization? If you want to implement hunting and that organization doesn't invest in training, doesn't invest in the people, people are not pushed to go in and do this kind of work, but instead are always in that firefighting mode of, oh, the system's down, let me fix it. Oh, we have an infection, let me go in and clean it out of the system. You're not going to be able to implement this. You need to have that environment that actually pushes you to this. It's just like we have talked for many years about, hey, this is how you fix the system and nobody does it, or only a handful do. And that's when we come back to that phrase, the material level of the organization.
As,
the group
as
you're
Michael Santarcangelo would say, how tall do I need to be to ride the ride?
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, what I'm hearing is this goes all the way back. I mean, this is old. This is Cliff Stahl in The Cuckoo's Egg. Noticing a discrepancy in the bill and tracking it down. I mean, he noticed something that was out of the ordinary. So the concept, the theoretical, is not new. So
it's old. It's not like Jack Daniel old, but it's old.
Yeah, it's getting there.
But you're right, Jeff. I mean, what's old is new again is certainly a valid commentary on hunting. But also I would have to agree with Carlos that hunting is more of a mature organization activity, I believe, because there is a fundamental tenet here, and that is we're looking for what is unknown bad. You know, known bad is covered. All of our existing defensive solutions that have signature-based technologies, certain level of heuristic technologies, they've got the known bad covered, right?
Well, that's after when you're defining.
When is it known?
Yeah. Paul and I were talking about this earlier before the broadcast. You know, there's a mature organization, and there's organizations that have invested in all the security technologies, the silver bullets. They've got them all, and yet they still get popped. They still get owned. There's still major breaches.
Well, that's the point. That's what opens up the market, frankly, for the hunting concept, because they're getting popped because people are crafting advanced malware manually, right? That's why they get popped.
Everything can be defeated, plus there's that level of, all the tech, every one of these protective technologies, there's a way to get around them. And what I'm hearing is the hunt is, assuming that that's taken place, then what do you look for?
Exactly. I feel like we should ask Jared another question, though.
We should.
So go ahead. I feel like we're... maybe I'll punt that back to Paul. Go ahead, Paul.
Sorry, Jared. So what else on hunting? What are some of the practical techniques that you would recommend to our listeners who are now interested in doing some hunting?
Yeah, so ultimately it's gathering tons of data, putting it into something that you can easily ingest and then analyze for anomalies, right? And then being able to quickly investigate those anomalies. And so that's where that power forensics concept comes in, right? You don't have time when you're, let's say, 100,000 endpoints in a network, right? You're scanning those. You have a process listing from 100,000 endpoints, just for simplicity's sake, and you have 400 really anomalous process names, right? You want to go investigate those systems. Well, you're not going to do 400 disk images and then bring those back to the forensics shop and give them 2 weeks to investigate each one of those, right? Because that's just not practical. So ultimately, you need to have people that have the skill, kind of enough of the skill to do forensic analysis. And then when they find a binary that's strange, they have enough of the skill to do enough malware reversing or binary reversing to determine whether or not that needs to be pushed up to kind of the next tier of reverse engineers, things of that nature. So ultimately, my perspective is a hunter is somebody that is very, very well rounded in kind of more advanced techniques of defense, right? So things like digital forensics and things like malware reverse engineering or memory forensics, things of that nature. But they're able to do it in a very rapid fashion. It's kind of the idea behind it.
Can I ask a question, Paul?
Mm-hmm.
So Jared, it feels to me like we're facing that same old problem in the information security industry of lack of enough talented people. How do you respond to that in the hunting context, in that we've got so many other things going on in the information security industry generally?
Yeah, so that I would say that is in fact one of the biggest problems, right? So ultimately there's not enough skilled technicians, quote unquote, to be able to perform hunting at the large scale or do things like digital forensics and malware reverse engineering and things of that nature, because over the past decade or so, we've been worried about making sure that all the patches are pushed out, or making sure that the email server is not messed up, or like in the Air Force, we once had the general's wife can't send him an email, and so everybody needs to drop everything and make sure that the general's wife has an exception that can send an email to her husband at work. And so ultimately that's where kind of this investment in people really comes in. But people really need to have the personal drive in order to help that out, right? Like, I could send you to as many training classes as I can, and you may not learn what you need to learn. But there are people that are going to open a book and read what they need to read and learn what they need to learn on their own. And so those are the types of people that we need to be encouraging and investing in.
So I have a question, sort of an application question. Paul and I were talking before the broadcast about, there's a lot of companies now that are migrating to the cloud. They're trying to outsource as much as they can IT and security and cybersecurity. For the companies out there that are kind of on board with that, shall we say, you know, what is the recommendation? What would you say to companies that are, they think they've outsourced all their security worries to the cloud or MSSP? What should they focus on from a hunt perspective?
Yeah, so, well, gosh, the cloud is a fun concept, right, from the forensics perspective, from the security perspective in general. I think
Keeps us all employed.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, so ultimately, I mean, like, let's say company X is using a cloud provider, and that cloud provider gets hacked, and company X, you know, their SQL database that has tons of personal information in it, gets accessed, and you know they lose tons of records. The company that's hosting the information probably isn't going to get as bad of marketing or as bad of press as the company whose information was stolen. Right. And so I think you still, at the end of the day, need to take a you can't just write the check and say, hey, it's in the cloud, it's, you know, not my problem anymore.
Right.
I think you need to still take a proactive approach, and a number of, like, just because it's in the cloud doesn't mean that you're not going to be able to provide the same type of security that you would otherwise, right? So you could still access those systems and query information on them, all that kind of stuff, run a forensic investigation. So, yeah, putting it up in the cloud is not a blank check to just pass the blame or the can't think of the word. Yeah, basically just passing the check over to somebody
else. Well, it's liability.
Liability.
Companies think that the liability is shifted to whoever the hosting providers are, the MSSPs.
Right. Yep. Yeah, so if that's how the company wants to run their organization, and at the end of the day, they are going to accept the risk of when that, you know, hosting provider gets hacked and their information gets stolen, and that's their prerogative. But I just think that, you know, at the end of the day, the consumer is going to say, hey, this company lost my information, and so that's going to affect the, you know, the company that's sending information into the cloud more so than the actual cloud provider itself.
So I have another question. Final question.
Make it a good one, Jeff, until we get to the five questions.
Which I've been wrestling with. Final question, make it a good one. I've been wrestling with this a lot. Have you got any thoughts, and this is going to be a very open question, have you got any thoughts about the juxtaposition of mobile devices and hunting?
Oh, boy. To be honest, I have very little experience with mobile devices. And I think that that's probably one of the bigger issues going forward. This whole, you know, BYOM or whatever the new, the little fancy acronym
whatever the acronym is.
Yeah.
BYO, fill in the blank.
Yeah, exactly. I think, you know, mobile devices, everybody stores all their information on them. And when somebody gets access to them, they have all your contacts. They have your home address. They have, you know, where you've been, what your schedule is, all that kind of stuff. And so, to be honest, I don't have a good answer for how you attack that problem. But I know that it is a problem that's just going to get worse and worse as we go forward. Just look at the fappening, right? That's a good example of people
don't
getting
mind if I do. Celebgate. Celebgate.
Yeah.
Celebgate. Okay.
I have a story off air for that, by the way.
Thanks, Jared. I think Paul's due to ask you the five.
Five questions with Security Weekly. Jared, are you ready to play five questions?
I am.
All righty. Three words to describe yourself.
Oh, gosh.
That's two.
Hipster is the last one.
Oh, gosh, hister. Hipster, even.
I like that answer. That was good.
Yeah.
That was good. Question number two. If you were to write a book about yourself, what would the title be?
Oh, gosh, hipster.
Yeah, no.
No.
Can I use the same answer? No, let's do From History Major to PowerShell Player, the Jared Atkinson story.
If you were a serial killer, what would be your weapon of choice?
PowerShell, obviously.
PowerShell. No. Probably an icicle.
Nice. Evidence. That's a popular answer.
Is it? Okay.
In the popular game of Ask Grabby Grabby, do you prefer to go first or second?
Definitely first. I'm a touchy-feely person.
Excellent. That's good to know when we see you at a conference. the final question. Choose two celebrities to be your parents.
Alive, dead, fictional, or otherwise.
Oh, gosh. George Clooney. Need the good looks. Okay. Let's see.
And now's the time to find out if you have mommy issues.
Yeah.
You want to choose someone hot, but then you're like, oh, no, that's my mom. I can't choose someone hot.
God, no, Susan Sarandon. Now that you've made me not have a hot mom.
Totally derailed the guy.
You threw me off, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you can have a hot mom. It's totally
nope.
Susan Sarandon's pretty. Wasn't she in, what was the baseball movie that she was in? Bull Durham.
Yeah.
She was hot in Bull Durham. Yeah.
She's also in Rocky Horror.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
She is?
Wow.
Yeah. Hey, Jeff, you're old.
Yes, I am.
Damn it.
Damn it, really, Janet. Susan Sarandon even came to my mind.
It was like the first celebrity that, no, that's good. Yeah. That's good.
Does she have anything in the fappening?
No, she did not.
Okay.
She is topless in a movie. I forget what it is, but I'm sure on Mr. Skin or something you could figure
Pretty
it out.
Pretty baby.
Nice.
Not that I know.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah.
Apparently, Jared will point us right at the correct website. So.
Excellent.
No worries.
We'll wait for that information. Jared, thank you very much for appearing on Security Weekly. It's wonderful having you talking about PowerShell and hunting. Stay tuned, everyone, for the next segment, which will be Security News. So stay tuned. Don't go anywhere.
Okay. Woot, woot.